All of this, we have to consult the Lord. So at this time, we have Dr. Robert Wright. He's a person that will lead us into a short devotion. Welcome again, ladies and gentlemen.
This morning, I have tried to make my research, my presentation, my devotional, fit with the agenda for today or for this week, research. And I've titled it, as you see on the screen, Research, Discovering Great Things About God. And when we do scientific research, once we study science in the true manner, as we ought, it can only lead us back to God. It can only point us back to the great genius behind creation and everything that we know of our existence. Heavenly Father, we ask you now to guide us as we share together in this brief devotion in Jesus' name. And I hope that as we focus on the devotional thought this morning, some of you may not agree with one or two things that I say, but I'm going to ask you to do the research and see what you discover, your researchers, all right? Okay, now, Zophar, the friend of Job, asked him a very poignant question. Canst thou, by searching, find out God? Now, this question is answered in Deuteronomy 29, verse 29. The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and our children forever, which means we can know nothing about God except that which he reveals to us about himself. The Apostle Paul tells us, for the invisible things or attributes of him from the creation are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that we are without excuse. So there should be no atheists in this world if they study nature properly. It will reveal many wonderful things about God. So all that we need to know about God for salvation can be known, for he has revealed them to us. But there are other things about God's creative genius that we can know in in order to better appreciate the beauty of creation. Is this moving? The science of psychosomatic relationship is the topic of Proverbs 17, verse 22. A merry heart doeth good like medicine, but a broken spirit dries up the bone. It has been proven that when people are happy, contented, the bone marrow produces more white and red blood cells, which boost the immune system. On the other hand, when they are in a grieving, poor, unhappy state of mind, it suppresses the power of the brain marrow to produce white red blood cells, which undermines the strength of the immune system. It literally dries up the bones. All right? Then, the heart with which we love, with which we love God and which feels emotions, referred to so often in the scripture as has been found to have over 40,000 neurons and functions like the brain. The new science is called neurocardiology. So you look at the Bible and it speaks so much about the heart as though the heart is a brain itself. Well, it has been discovered that the heart does function like a brain. When you lose a loved one, when your girlfriend or your boyfriend forsake you, or your husband or your wife forsake you, and you feel that pain, you don't feel it in your brain, you feel it in the heart. And when you remember the emotions, you remember it and you feel it in your heart. That's the science, the new science of neurocardiology. The Bible has spoken about that for a long time. And then the Lord told Israel to circumcise their male children on the eighth day after birth. Why? Science has now discovered that on the eighth day, vitamin K in the blood is at its highest. On the eighth day. It is the clotting agent in the blood, so healing takes place much faster when the child is circumcised on the eighth day. We're talking about science proving the accuracy of the Bible. Then, the Bible contains many other scientific truths that will only be unearthed by research, biblical research. These truths serve to cement our faith in God. Here's a little research that I did, and I'm going to ask you to do your own research to see whether it makes sense. Why is the sky blue? Scientists may try to answer that question according to theories which may seem specious, but which cannot be accurately proven, like combination of gases in the atmosphere, etc. But the Bible gives a logical reason which demonstrates that Earth is the special object of the attention of the family in heaven. In Ezekiel 1, the prophet saw four creatures, which he describes as cherubims. They each have four faces, four sides, four arms at their four sides, four wings covering their arms, and two stretching upward that touch in a sort of a square base upon which a crystal or glass firmament or pavement rests. Follow me carefully. The likeness of the firmament above the heads of these living creatures was the color of an awesome crystal stretched out over their heads. And under the firmament, their wings spread out straight, one toward another. And above the firmament, over their heads, was the likeness of a throne, in appearance like a sapphire stone. On the likeness of the throne was a likeness with the appearance of a man high above it. So we're looking at the throne of God here. Whereas sapphire vary in color, the one that Ezekiel saw was most likely a blue sapphire stone, because John the Revelator saw the same picture and describes the firmament as a sea of glass, referring it to the sea around the island of Patmos. He's describing it according to his frame of reference. And if you have gone out to the ocean early one morning, you'll see the vast sea looking like glass. But what color does it have? Blue, right? Now, the color of the sea, some people think that the color of the sky is taken from the color of the sea. It's the other way around. The sea takes its color from the sky. If you go to the sea on an overcast day, it looks aqua. More greenish kind of a thing, right? But on a clear, bright day, it has blue. It is reflecting the blueness of the sky. But where does the sky get its blueness from? Let's carry on. Moses and Aaron and the elders of Israel saw God's feet resting on this pavement that Ezekiel and John described. It says, then Moses went up, also Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw the God of Israel. And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of sapphire stone, and it was like the heavens in its clarity. So look at the heavens on a cloudless day. What do you see? It's like you're looking through an endless, a vast glass, as it were, but ocean of blue is what you see. Now, if God is sitting on his throne, with his feet resting on this pavement, and these men are looking up, they see God's feet on the pavement, and the reflection of blue throughout the heavens, what does that tell us as to why the sky is blue? Now, what is the proximity of earth to heaven? The Lord says, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Jesus said that we should not swear by heaven nor by earth, for it is his footstool. These are poetic expressions, but they speak to biblical truths. Again, Isaiah states, it is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain. These passages, though expressed in poetic form, present a picture of God sitting on his sapphire blue colored throne, which rests on a crystal firmament pavement, with his feet resting on the pavement, on the circle or firmament of the earth. So the color of the throne reflects through our universe. Earth is referred to as the blue planet. There is none other like it. What is the implication for us as human beings? It means that we are the single most important objects of God's love and attention in this universe. God is not afar off. He is very close to planet Earth. The rainbow is evidence of his covenant of salvation, and the blue sky is evidence of his imminence. Moses described the pavement beneath his feet as sapphire, as clear as the heavens. John describes it as a sea of glass. Ezekiel describes it as a vast crystal with a sapphire throne resting on it and God sitting on the throne. We are now standing beneath the sea of glass, but one day we will stand on the sea of glass. When the curtain of the heavens is pulled aside at last, we will see in full glory the throne of God resting on the crystal, and we shall stand before him in jubilation. That's what the scripture says in Revelation chapter 15. And I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. We cannot, by searching, find out God, but we can, by researching, discover many wonderful things about the character, plans, and creative genius of God. And I say amen. So, I'm going to invite you as researchers, Christian researchers, to do your own research on this topic. It was very intriguing for me, and I don't think I've exhausted it. And I would like for you to do your own research, because nature reveals many wonderful things about God and about his creative genius. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the wonderful things that you have revealed to us in nature. As we study and as we discover truth, may we give you the honor and the glory and not ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce to you once again the president of Northern Caribbean University. He is Dr. Lincoln Paul Edwards, and he is a graduate of the University of the West Indies and Loma Linda University, and holds a bachelor's degree in chemistry, a doctor of pharmacology degree, as well as a doctor of dental surgery degree. Dr. Edwards has impacted the lives of many through his research in the area of diabetes and also in the area of hypertension, with over 50 peer-reviewed papers and abstracts, and has obtained 2 National Institutes of Health grants in the United States of America. Amidst his hectic professional and philanthropic schedule, he still finds the time to work for the Lord and is an experienced lay preacher and has served in various capacities within the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Dr. Lincoln Paul Edwards is married to Sandra Taylor, and together they have 3 children, Alex, Ross Andre, and Alexa. When he is not spending time with family or doing research on how to improve the health and well-being of others, he enjoys playing a friendly game of soccer. Ladies and gentlemen, the president of Northern Caribbean University, Dr. Lincoln Paul Edwards.
Thank you, Dr. Corey. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Board of Governors of Northern Caribbean University, its administration, students, faculty, and staff, I welcome each and all of you to Jamaica, and particularly to Northern Caribbean University. You have come to participate in the 3rd Universities of the Inter-American Division Research Conference, which is an initiative of the Inter-American Division Department of Education. You have come from Adventist University of the Antilles in Puerto Rico, Adventist University of Chile in Chile, Columbia Adventist University, Medellin, Colombia, Dominican Adventist University in the Dominican Republic, Linda Vista University from southern Mexico, Loma Linda University, my alma mater, from California, United States, Northern Caribbean University right here, our host university, University of Monte Morelos in Monte Morelos, Mexico, University of Navajo from Mexico, University of the Southern Caribbean, that's our sister institution over there in Trinidad, Peruvian Union University from Lima, Peru, University of the West Indies, also my alma mater right here in Mona, and also from University of the West Indies, Cave Hill in Barbados, University of Massachusetts in Massachusetts, United States of America, University of Texas at Houston, Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio, the National Technological Institute of Mexico, and of course the Geoscience Research Institute in Loma Linda, California. And there may be others from other universities. I say welcome to all of you. We are excited and pleased that you are here in Jamaica to share this historic conference with us. This event is happening as Northern Caribbean University celebrates 100 years of existence on this Mandeville main campus of the university. And we are delighted to have our friends come from all over the division to worship with us, to share with us, to exchange research ideas. We hope that you will find your accommodations the food, the drink, and our campus to your liking. For those of you who are staying in the homes of faculty, staff, and members of our community, we want you to feel at home, make yourselves comfortable, and the families you will meet are now your new family. So enjoy the Jamaican hospitality, enjoy Northern Caribbean University. Let's exchange ideas and have a good time together. So again, I say welcome and God bless you.
Our first plenary session will be chaired by Dr. Wilmore Webley. He's currently a tenured associate professor of biology, microbiology, and the director of pre-med pre-health advising at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. Webley is a Jamaican, and he attended high school. He did his undergraduate degree at Northern Caribbean University, and he completed his MS and PhD degrees at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. And his area of expertise is in immunology, infectious disease, host pathogen interaction, and a concentration on vaccine development. He's a Fulbright scholar and has been a recipient of many awards. At this time, I'll just invite Dr. Webley to come forward. He'll be chairing this session, and he'll introduce the main feature speaker for this session.
Good morning, everyone. It is good to see so many people interested in research and research of various types in the audience this morning. It is my pleasure to chair this session and to introduce to you our featured speaker, Dr. Timothy Standish. I met Dr. Standish almost 20 years ago when we invited him to come to the University of Massachusetts to give a presentation on creation science. While we had a group there, Seventh-day Adventist group, on our public university campus, and he did an amazing job. Dr. Standish is the senior scientist at the Geoscience Research Institute at Loma Linda University in California. He did his bachelor's degree in zoology with a minor in chemistry at Andrews University. He went on to do a master's degree in biology. Dr. Standish actually hails from Sydney, Australia, and grew up in the Far East. He's a great traveler and loves to go around the world. His MS degree in biology constituted his studies on brachiopods. He went on to George Mason University, where he was awarded the PhD in environmental biology and public policy. And this was largely based on his research on molecular techniques useful for the identification and classification of nematodes. These are worms. Dr. Standish is an educator at heart. He has taught in the colleges and universities in the United States, in the UK, in South Africa, areas of Austria, in Kenya, in the Philippines. He has taught public high school science classes in the United States, as well as working closely with science teachers in secondary schools and tertiary schools to boost their science education. Dr. Standish does a lot of public speaking, and he covers topics on intelligent design, on molecular behavior in crickets. I would love to hear more about that. He deals with topics in his publications, his many publications, on faith and science. He explores filmmaking in his spare time. He looks at the interaction between science, faith, and public policy. Dr. Standish, we're grateful to have you here, and I invite you now to share with us in this first session your topic on why only a biblical view of origins can save the world. Good to have you.
Thank you so much. Well, it's my great pleasure to be here in Jamaica. This is not the first time I have been here. In fact, I worked on a research project down around Montego Bay. It was a good kind of research project, studying a kind of a species of clam that you find down here, and then a quite similar species that you can find along the east coast of the United States, up to about Cape Hatteras. That was fun. They're only found on gently sloping, wave-washed beaches. I wish I'd kept up with that. But in any case, we're going to talk about some other things this morning. This particular presentation is a look at how different lines of work that I've been privileged to be engaged with really come together. And this is something that we all need to be thinking about if we are going to be doing research. The individual, very specific research projects that we do ultimately fit into a big picture. And that big picture is important. The details are important, and the big picture is important. So we're going to look at a few details in seemingly very different areas. But before we get into it, I actually have a quiz for you. So let's start off with the quiz. Who here has heard of Creation Sabbath? Very good. There's one person here who gets an A. Creation Sabbath is an official Sabbath in the calendar of special days that the General Conference has. And it happens to be the fourth Sabbath of every October. So who can tell me what the date of Creation Sabbath is this year? Okay, there will be another test. This quiz will be repeated. It is the 26th of October of this year. I encourage you to consider doing something special on Creation Sabbath for this year. I know that there was some participation here in the Inter-American Division last year, so there are people here who know about it. I want to hear about a massive celebration of Creation Sabbath here at Northern Caribbean University. Now, let's get into why only a biblical view of origins can save the world. And I want to show you a picture. I wish you could see it a little bit more clearly. Where we come from makes a huge difference. You'll notice that in the introduction that was given to me just now, you were told where I come from. I was born in Sydney, Australia. It makes a difference. It tells you something about you, about me, and it tells me something about myself. I am an Australian. I have an Australian passport. I have certain rights and privileges because I'm an Australian that I do not have in Jamaica because I'm not Jamaican, or in Mexico because I'm not Mexican, or in Costa Rica, or wherever we come from. It makes a difference. It changes how we view ourselves. The gentleman that you can see in the lower left of this photograph here is my uncle. He was my father's identical twin. And I'm going to tell you something about him that will change your view a little bit of me. Okay. My uncle, my father's identical twin, was president of this institution for some years, back in the late 60s and early 70s. I was just with my aunt on Saturday night. You can see her in this photo as well. And she especially wanted me to give her greetings to this institution, which she still calls her second home. Now, unfortunately, my uncle was unable to do that because he died last year in November. But I can tell you that he used to tell us all sorts of stories, wonderful stories, about his time here. This is a storied place for me. I've never been here before, and yet I already have a kind of very excited view of it. It was a thrill for me to come in through that front gate and think, wow, there's a family connection here. There is something very special. There is also a family connection between you and me, a very real family connection. And so we are going to look at how that works a little bit. I want to draw your attention to a specific text. This is 1 Corinthians 1, 21 through 25. For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. I don't know what institution you come from. I don't know what institutions you studied at. But I do know one thing, and that is that you are like me. You went to university because you sought knowledge and wisdom. If you were privileged enough to go to a Christian Seventh-day Adventist university, you got those things. I have been, and I have worked at both Seventh-day Adventist universities and secular universities. And it has always been a wonderful experience. I have no complaints. But I can tell you that the value that a Christian Seventh-day Adventist Bible-centered education gives you is inestimable. I praise God that I had the privilege of studying at Weimar College with Wesley. And I also praise God that I had the privilege of studying at Andrews University. And I praise God that I had the privilege of studying at George Mason University, of course. But that wisdom that is found in God's Word and that permeates the curriculum of a truly Seventh-day Adventist university is something that you can get nowhere else. Let's talk a little bit about that biblical view. What is it? Well, yes, I'm going to make this bold claim. This is my thesis. Only a biblical view of origins can save the world because of these things. It is true. When something is true, it doesn't matter how much talking or how much speculating or even how much evidence there is for it. Truth is true in and of itself. The Bible is true. It is a truthful account of events that have occurred over the course of history. It is not a lie. And it is not surprising to find that so much science, so much archaeology, so much of what we study in biology really is so profoundly consistent with the claims of Scripture. It provides a correct view of the nature of man. This is essential. Without that, we are lost. We don't even know who we are. It provides a correct view of the value of human life, something that we need to spend an awful lot more time thinking about. Every human life is of infinite value, and it is so easy in our modern world to imagine that people of other races, people of different ages, people with different ideas from ourselves, people who have done wicked things, people who are unintelligent or more intelligent than we are. It is so easy to imagine that their value is somehow or other less than our own, but that Jesus Christ died for each one of them is proof that every human being is of infinite, infinite value. The Bible provides a correct view of man's relationship with other men and women, of course. I'm using men in the generic sense there. It provides a correct view of man's relationship with nature, essential at this particular point in history. As we hear people talking about all kinds of environmental things, if we get it wrong, we're not going to be helping. It provides a correct view of man's relationship with God, our Creator. And I would add that false views inevitably lead to suffering and death. So what is this biblical view? Occasionally I might have to give the secret signal. Yeah. The biblical view of origins is this: God, who transcends time and space, created a very good world. Sin corrupted the creation, and this view is foundational to Bible-based soteriology, the story of salvation that the Bible tells. We were created by grace, there was a fall from grace, and through grace we are saved. Let's diagram that out. Here is the good creation, and then along comes sin. What is the result of sin? Death. And a broken creation, something that we can very easily see around us. Logically, then, the solution to this problem that I think most human beings recognize, except for Darwinists, who believe this is the miracle that made us, all the death and suffering, victory over sin is the logical solution. We have then victory over death, because sin is the cause of death, and we have a good new creation that can result from that. This is the story of the Bible, which I encourage you to read if you have not done so. This is laid out many, many times in lots of different ways, but I like the way that Paul puts it in Romans 5. You know, usually I don't understand Paul very well, but in Romans 5 he says the same thing over and over again, and even somebody who is not a theologian like myself can understand precisely what he is saying. He says, therefore, through one man's offense, who is that one man? Adam, your father and mine. He offended. Because of that, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation. Even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, also by one man's obedience, that man being Jesus Christ, many will be made righteous. That's it. That's it right there. You will note how the creation and salvation are indivisibly linked in Scripture. Let's look at a different view of history. I need to apologize. For some reason or other, it didn't occur to me that this was also going to be in Spanish. So I apologize to those of you who speak Spanish. No habla español. But I have quickly tried to put the Spanish into some of these slides, and it may be helpful. I hope so. So here is Charles Darwin talking. Now remember that the Christian worldview revolves around grace. Okay? Look at what the Darwinian worldview revolves around in this statement. He says, "And we have seen in the chapter on the struggle for existence that it is the most closely allied forms, varieties of the same species, and species of the same genus or related genera generally come into the severest competition with each other. Consequently, each new variety or species during the progress of its formation will generally press hardest on the nearest, its nearest kindred and tend to exterminate them." I want you to think about the history of the 20th century because this principle was put into practice during the 20th century. But it was put into practice before that. In fact, and I hope that I don't get, into too much trouble for saying this, but many of you are here in Jamaica today or in this part of the world because people viewed the world in terms of people who are superior and people who are inferior. And those inferior people were felt to be less valuable, and as a consequence, their lives were not respected. Their freedom was not respected. It wasn't even recognized. In fact, it is shocking to read what people have written over the course of history on these, along these lines. You will be relieved to know that if your ancestry is African, you are not alone. In fact, almost every kind of person, every race has suffered this in various ways. The Slavs, of course, being a very, very spectacular example. In fact, I've been told that the word slave comes from Slav, who were enslaved a lot. Now, in this Darwinian view, Darwin sort of puts it this way. How did we get to where we are? How did we get here? He said, had he, that's man, not been subject during primeval times to natural selection, assuredly he would never have attained his present rank. So in this Darwinian view, human beings, just like every other organism, is being selected in various ways. And the superior rise to the top. You can guess who Charles Darwin thought the superior race was. They all looked like him, except some had more hair. He talks about it, you know. Talks about the Caucasian rising to their current rank and how the Negro would go extinct. And then the gap between humans and chimpanzees would be wider than it is today. This kind of thinking led to horrors in the 20th century. We're not talking about in the 19th century. Or the 18th century. We're talking in the 20th century. Do you know that in the United States, they actually put an African on display with monkeys and things at the St. Louis World's Fair to illustrate evolution. And then, what were they going to do with him afterwards? They gave him to the Bronx Zoo. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. But if you embrace this view, you can deny it and all day long. If you embrace this view, you must believe that some people are more closely related to inferior organisms in your, you know, in this hierarchy of organisms that you have in your head, that some people, it's their destiny to go extinct. Natural selection has to act to make us better. That's the Darwinian view. We see this Darwinian view then playing out in different political philosophies. Here is a nice statement from Adolf Hitler talking about this. You will notice, by the way, we're talking about this struggle for survival, right? What was the title of Hitler's book? Mein Kampf, My Struggle. He was a Darwinist through and through. He wrote, "By means of the struggle, the elites are continually renewed. The law of selection justifies this incessant struggle by allowing the survival of the fittest. Christianity is a rebellion against natural law, a protest against nature. Taken to its logical extreme, Christianity would mean the systematic cultivation of the human failure." How easy it was to justify, first of all, slaughtering the handicapped, and then slaughtering the Jews, and then slaughtering a bunch of other people as well. It was justified in his mind by science. It is worth pointing out that while Hitler killed his tens of millions, Marxism killed its hundreds of millions, or at least around 100 million, in the 20th century. And you will notice that that political philosophy, even though we think of these things as being completely different, actually build off the same foundation. Marx talks about this very clearly, but here is just the first sentence of the Communist Manifesto. "The history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggles." You see, Marxism simply puts the struggle somewhere else. Have you ever wondered why Marxism doesn't bring peace? It always brings division and conflict and so on. It is specifically because of this. People do not see themselves as equal. They see themselves as being in various classes, men and women, old and young, workers and management, black and white. It doesn't matter. Hispanic and, you know, everybody else. Everybody is split into different classes, and everybody is in a struggle. That is the Marxist view of reality. I'm sorry, I should have brought that up there for you. Compare that with the biblical view. "There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." There is a reason why we sit here today peacefully, not worried. It's called love. It is what Christianity brings, true biblical Christianity. It isn't always easy because we're always tempted to think that we're better or more valuable than everybody else. But Christianity tells us no. It tells us that we are all one. And living by that principle brings inestimable benefits. Here's another statement by Charles Darwin. "No one who has attended to the breeding of domestic animals will doubt that this," that's medical care for the sick and vaccinations, "must be highly injurious to the race of man. It is surprising how soon a want of care, or care wrongly directed, leads to the degeneration of a domestic race, but excepting in the case of man himself, hardly anyone is so ignorant as to allow his worst animals to breed. You know, it amazes me that in our society today, we see this view played out regularly. I know that abortion, for example, is very, very controversial. But there is a reason why babies of African ancestry are aborted at a far higher rate than babies of other races. Okay? And I will tell you that it is this idea put into practice. This is explicitly spelled out by the people who started up places like Planned Parenthood. Incredible. What does the Bible say? Does it say abort the babies you don't want? Does it say make the woman's womb as the most dangerous place for a baby in America? Which it is, by the way. No. The Bible says defend the weak and the fatherless. Uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. Totally different view that springs from our understanding of what a human being is, created in the image of God. All of us descendants of Adam and Eve. All of us descendants of Noah as well. Spiritually, we are descendants of Abraham as well. And we are sons and daughters of God. A very, very different view. The Bible tells us, "For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well." That is every work that God has made. That is everybody in this room right now. That is everybody who attends this university and the various institutions that you come from. Everybody who is outside those gates and not allowed in. Every single one of them, fearfully and wonderfully made, knit together by God in their mother's womb. These are the people whom we as Christians are called to share the gospel with. I'm going to skip over a whole bunch of slides because I do want to end with one here. Oh, there's so much interesting stuff here. Let's see if I can do it this way as well. All sorts of interesting stuff in nature. Ah. There we go. Oh, I even had some great chemistry in there for Dr. Edwards. Yeah. Bible also tells us there are three things that are too amazing for me. Four that I do not understand: the way of an eagle in the sky, the way of a snake on a rock, the way of a ship in the high seas, in the way of a man with a young woman. The Bible is not about individual things. The Bible is about relationships between different organisms, relationships between humans, relationships between humans and their environment, relationships between animals and their environment, and so on. What it does is it depicts the creation as this marvelous integrated thing. The Bible also tells us about our relationship with our Creator. Jesus put it this way. He said, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." That is the biblical view. If we adopt the Darwinian view, do you think we're going to be working together? Do you think that the metaphor of all of us being one members of the body of Christ is going to work? Of course not. The Christian view, the biblical view, is totally different. And Paul lays it out this way. He says, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that anyone can boast. No struggle. Surrender, not struggle. And look at where he immediately goes to. Immediately he transitions to, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. This is why I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek, for all of us. Ultimately, the reason that a biblical view of creation is the only thing that can save the world is because Jesus Christ is our Creator and Redeemer, and only Jesus saves. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Standish. We have time to take a few questions. Do you have any questions? Out of the presentation, any hand. Dr. Standish,
I was very confusing or very thorough.
I think you were very thorough. My question is, what do you say to current secular geologists, people who study the columns and look at the geological columns and say, there is evidence there that this is a way older Earth than the creation Earth, young Earth theory that we have? How do you get to that person who is not a Seventh-day Adventist and don't even believe the Word of God?
I would say a couple of things about that. Number one, if you're going to talk with somebody who is an expert in a given field, do not try to take them on in that field. You are not going to come to a geologist with a killer geology argument. You will have to show them something else that is compelling to them. So I would encourage you to get them to talk with you about what you are an expert in. So in my particular case, I would invite the geologist to talk with me a little bit about biology and how biology works and why it is that geology presents massive problems for biology. It really doesn't work very well. For example, the earliest evidence of life on Earth is, according to the standard, I'm going to give you the standard numbers, I don't believe these, okay, is over 4.1 billion years old, according to all of the standard interpretations. Those of you who know how this model of how the Earth was formed is, understand that the Earth may, in fact, not even have had a crust at that particular point. It was a hot, molten ball, according to the current understanding. There is no time for biology to come into existence in the geologic column. Even though people talk about all these billions of years, there is not time, actually, for life to come into existence. And there are other kinds of things. But I know I can tell you that life appears to be designed, not the product of the Darwinian process. So I would encourage them to talk about that with me. If you're a theologian, you know what? Don't give up the authority of your discipline. Talk about theology. Make them come and fight on your field. Don't go and fight on their field. You will lose. Okay? Talk about what you know. And only talk about what you know. Don't get tempted off. So that would be my basic response. Yeah.
You're open to answering questions.
Oh, I'm happy to answer questions.
Yeah.
Sure. My email address is tstandish, tstandish, at llu.edu. I don't personally have a social, but you can contact me through the Geoscience Research Institute Facebook page and our web page, which is grisda.org. One question that I have for you is this: when is creation Sabbath? October 26, right. October 26, fabulous. I want you to be thinking throughout this conference, what can we do that is fantastic? What can we do that is a witness to our community? Not just, you know, don't just keep it inside the church. How can we reach out to the communities that our institutions are in and share the everlasting gospel of Revelation 14, 6, and 7, which is centered on worship of who? He who created heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. This is a fabulous opportunity for us. You can always also go to the Creation Sabbath website and find resources and other things there. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Thank you very much. This ends the preliminary session. I invite the organizers up now for A1.
Good morning, everyone. It's time for the breakout sessions. Already the chairpersons are in place at the respective sites. For microbiology, Dr. Olunge will be the chairperson and you will remain in here. For those who are interested in microbiology, you'll remain inside the gymnatorium. For those who are interested in public health, you will go over to the Michael. Where is Dr. Muche? Dr. Muche, could you be my point person? For those who are interested, just gather around Dr. Muche. Transportation is on the outside to take you over to the Michael. For those interested in attending the Issues in Education session, your session is in the Distance Education Conference Room, and your point person is Dr. Quarry, and she's right here. So you may start moving. Transportation is on the outside to take you to this location. Once again, microbiology, you remain here. Public health, you're going over to the Michael. Dr. Muche is your point person. And those interested in issues in education will go with Dr. Quarry. And the bus is on the outside to transport you to this location. Thank you. For those of you who will remain for microbiology, if you're comfortable coming forward, please do so right now. Thank you.